In the book of Exodus, chapter 26, we're going to continue in our series on the book of Exodus. We're in the tabernacle. We've kind of taken a sidestep here, going verse by verse and chapter by chapter from all the furniture. We're going to be going next week into the furniture, one of the furniture pieces in the tabernacle. But last week we talked about the boards. That was kind of a boardy sermon, wasn't it? And then we talked about the week before that about the curtains. And you know, I never thought in my life I could ever bring a sermon about curtains. But I did. It's amazing what you figure out you can do. It's like the time the preacher went to the nursing home to pay a visit. And every time he came around this one side, there was this little old lady sitting in the in a wheelchair, and every time he walked by, she said, "You look like my third husband." He didn't think anything of it. He kept going around, and he came back, and she said, every time, "You look like my third husband." So finally, about the fifth or sixth time, he finally asked her, said, "Lady, how many husbands you have?" She said, "Two." So sometimes we can be a little confused talking about curtains or boards. Well, we've got two more curtains to cover. Well, we've got another one later on, but we've got two more curtains to cover today. One of them is called the veil, and the other one's called the screen or the door. It's very interesting in the aspect that there were only three entrances in the tabernacle. Couldn't go by a side door. Couldn't go in the back door. Had to go through one of the three entrances to get inside. All of them faced east. Every time you set up the tabernacle, you had to set it up the same way. You couldn't just say, "Well, you know, let's face it west this time and get that nice sunset over there. It looks so beautiful as we get off work." Can't do that. It's got to face east. And so the question really is, you say, why are all these things so important in the Bible? Why is it so explicit? Why is it so intricate that even to the point of the direction it faced, folks, everything about the tabernacle, everything, every little minute detail, every pin, every rope, every curtain, every piece of furniture, whether it was a plate, a bowl, a pitchfork, a shovel, or whatever it was, it pictured Jesus. Matthew chapter 24 and verse 27 says, "For as lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be." Even to the point it pointed east so that they could understand that one day Jesus would be coming from that direction. They always wanted to be facing that direction. Zechariah, the 14th chapter. Put your ribbon here in Exodus. You say, "Well, where's Zechariah, preacher?" Easy to find. Second to last book of the Old Testament, go to Matthew, turn back, and there's Malachi, and then Zechariah. Zechariah has 14 chapters. The last chapter is right next to Malachi. That's the chapter I want you to look at real quick. Zechariah, the 14th chapter, look at verse 3 and 4. Why is facing the east so important? Because everything they did pointed to Jesus. Look at verse 3. "Then the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations as he fights in the day of battle." Now, this is the last days. In fact, in particular, this is the battle for Jerusalem. Verse 4, "And in that day his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which faces Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall be split in two from east to west, making a very large valley. Half of the mountain shall move toward the north and half of it toward the south." You see, they placed that tabernacle facing east so that they would ever be before the coming of the Lord. This is yet to come. One day the Lord is going to come back the second time. You know, there are some of the rabbis. We're talking Orthodox rabbis. We're talking the Hasidic Jewish rabbis are starting to talk about the second coming of the Messiah. Now, notice I didn't say the coming of the Messiah. I'm talking about the second coming of the Messiah. Some of these rabbis are starting to say, you know, we need to take a closer examination of Yeshua, what we call Jesus. They're starting to say, we believe that he was the Messiah now. And maybe perhaps we ought to investigate this more and find out what this is all about. Well, preacher, what is this? How can it be that lost people are talking about Jesus as the Messiah? How can this be? Folks, this just might be the beginning of God bringing out the 144,000. You don't know. 144,000 of the Jewish evangelists who are going to go out through the whole world in the tribulation period and preach Jesus. Ooh, it's a scary time, but it's an exciting time at the same. We see that they're looking toward the east. And then we see the three entrances are very simple. The gate, that's the first entrance you come to. And then there's the door, that's also called the outer veil there at the tabernacle itself. And then there's the veil, which was in the inner side, what they called the inner veil. Now the number three represents the Godhead. It represents the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You see, the gate was where you came to bring your sacrifice. So the gate pictures for us Jesus, the sacrificial Lamb of God. It pictures for us the Savior who came to seek and to save that which was lost. Next, you come to the door. Jesus said, I am the door. What is that? He said, if you come in and out, you'll find pasture. Basically, what he's saying is, I am the way of salvation. But also the door led into the holy place where the priest served and where they received their sanctification. Beloved, that's a picture of the ministry of the Holy Spirit. In that we come to serve the Lord as we are saved to serve. We are born again to serve God in this life. Now, by be as simple as Suzanne Wesley, who raised two wonderful boys, who when they went to the time of preaching, the Church of England would not let them preach in the churches, would not give them license to preach in their churches. So those boys said, you know, God is more important to them. And they went down to their dad's tombstone there in the local cemetery and preached from their father's tombstone. What a pulpit. To think that might be the only service you do. But look how the Wesley boys touched the world. You say, well, my service isn't really important. I'm just putting the oil in the lamp, or I'm just putting the showbread on the table, or I'm just putting the incense on the incense altar there. But lo and behold, beloved, your service to the Lord does not go without notice. Jesus said, if you can give just but a cup of cold water in my name, you will receive a reward. Folks, listen, we need more Christians that are what I call cold water Christians. Not that they come and throw cold water on everybody, but that they come into our situations and bring a refreshing drink that would give us strength and encouragement. We need Christians today that are willing to encourage. We need Christians today, like Jesus said, bringing cups of cold water. You say, well, I don't know what I can do. I just don't know. What can I do? Can you hand out a cup of cold water? One of my favorite jobs in the church, I think is one of the best jobs we have. I think it's one of the greatest jobs we have. I got my best man on it, and that's that right there at the door when you first come in. To think that all you got to do to be in service to the Lord is to shake hands with a smile on your face and say, come on in. Wouldn't you like to have it? See, Walmart, I think, picked up on that. I'm going to tell that, you know, one day when I see Mr. Walton perhaps in heaven, I'm going to say, you know, I think you picked up on that at the churches where you used to go, and you thought, well, man, I need a greeter in my store. Exodus chapter 26. Let's start with verse 31. You shall make a veil woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread and fine woven linen. It shall be woven with an artistic design of cherubim. You shall hang it upon the four pillars of acacia wood, overlaid with gold. Their hooks shall be gold upon the four sockets of silver. And you shall hang the veil from the clasps. And then you shall bring the ark of the testimony in there behind the veil. The veil shall be a divider for you between the holy place and the most holy. You shall put the mercy seat upon the ark of the testimony in the most holy. You shall set the table outside the veil, the lampstand across from the table on the side of the tabernacle toward the south. And you shall put the table on the north side. And you shall make a screen for the door of the tabernacle, woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread, and fine woven linen made by a weaver. And you shall make for the screen five pillars of acacia wood, and overlay them with gold. Their hooks shall be gold, and you shall cast five sockets of bronze for them. We see two things here, beloved. We see the veil of the tabernacle, and we see the door of the tabernacle. Each one of them is very important. Not a piece of furniture, not a rope, not a nail, not a socket, not a small little piece of that tabernacle was unimportant. Every bit of it spoke of Jesus. We see in verse 31 the authorization for the veil. God told Moses, make me a veil. Make me a veil. In verse 31, the Bible says simply, you shall make a veil. Look at the designation of the veil. It's to be woven. It's to be a special thing. You just don't get you a sheet and do some tie-dye on it and throw it up. You know, some of those, remember those old bead curtains we used to have back in the 60s? Played that Ravi Shankar music, you know, and that put those bead things up, man, farm out and all that good stuff, you know, right arm and everything. We see the four colors of this veil were very important. You just didn't throw something up here, folks. This was very important. It was to be woven. It was to be done something that an artisan would do. And so we see that somebody was chosen. Some people were chosen. I am so shocked. I can't even sew a button on my coat. I am so awed at people who can sew, let alone people who can crochet and people who can quilt. Those people to me are fascinating. I tried that one time when we were stuck in the great storm of 79. I tried to do a latchwork rug. Man, that really didn't work out. You wouldn't even put on a floor for your dog to lay on. It was that bad. So I am impressed with people who have these kind of skills. But God uses even people like this who have these skills to do this woven thing. And you see, you say, well, I don't have any skills. Folks, listen. Whatever you have, use it for the glory of God. You say, well, I can't do this. Don't sit around and think about what you can't do for the Lord. Don't sit around and say, well, I can't do this and I can't do that. I just might as well not do anything for the Lord. Many of you have perhaps the gift of encouragement. You have the gift of discernment. Whatever gifts God has given you, folks, find them out. Use them for the honor and glory of His name. But we see these four colors. They're distinct pictures of the Master's characteristics. We see the Messiah in the blue thread. The blue pictured for us the incarnation of Christ as He came down from heaven, as He came among us, and the Word became flesh, the Bible says in John, the first chapter. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Beloved, this blue pictured Jesus, who was a King of glory and is the King of glory. He came down, left that throne, passed by the portals of glory. All the angels rushed upon the parapets of heaven, looking down upon the starry sky as Jesus came in the form of a human child there in Bethlehem. Oh, heaven must have shouted with joy and wept at the very same time, that God would come in flesh upon this world to redeem mankind. God in flesh, the incarnation. And oh, they must have wept thinking, knowing what the world would do with such a lovely Lord as Jesus. We see God in flesh in blue. And second, we see the purple. That pictures Jesus' messianic sovereignty as the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Oh, the Bible says that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that He is Lord. Folks, listen, one day the whole world is going to know who He is. All these people, these skeptics, these atheists, these agnostics, these people who revel in their rebellious nature towards God are going to have to stand in front of God one day and say, You are Lord. I'm not happy or excited about anybody going to hell. In fact, the truth of it is, the Lord loved us all. The Bible says, for God so loved the world. He loves those atheists. He loves those skeptics. And folks, it's our responsibility to love them too, that we might share the love of Christ with them. But we see here this purple represents the King of Kings. And then scarlet. The scarlet color, the deep red color of the curtain, pictures the Messiah's mission as the suffering Lamb of God. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. The Bible says He came to die for our sins. And finally, the white pictures the sinlessness of the Son of God. That white and beautiful byssus woven linen cloth shows us that there is a Savior who came. Man without sin. One human being that never sinned. One human being, God in human flesh. One person, what Paul calls the second Adam, who came in perfection that we might see Him, that He might fulfill the law, and in fulfilling the law, die for us that we might have eternal life. We see the designation of the veil. Look at the design of the veil. They have cherubim there. The Bible says in verse 31, going to do this, and the Bible says, and it'd be woven with an artistic design of cherubim. Now, cherubim were very unique. Now, some people say there were three cherubim on it. Some people say they were two. There's even those who say there were four cherubim on it. And the reason why they say four is they cite Revelation 4:6. It says, before the throne of the sea of glass, like crystal, in the midst of the throne and around the throne were four living creatures full of eyes in front and back. Ezekiel even describes them further. Ezekiel talks about them in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 10. Ezekiel chapter 10, he even gives, I think, a better description. It's fascinating to me, but in Ezekiel chapter 10, verse 20 and 21, the Bible says, this is the living creature I saw under the God of Israel by the river Chebar, and I knew they were cherubim. Each one had four faces, and each one had four wings, and the likeness of the hands of a man was under their wings. And the likeness of their faces was the same as the faces which I had seen by the river Chebar. Their appearance and their persons, they each went straight forward. Very interesting creature. These are the creatures that literally guard around the throne of God. These are the creatures that are very unique, eyes all over them. And we're not talking about maybe like you see on a peacock feather, but these were eyes. I think they were literal eyes. And their hands were under their wings, and they had four wings. Now, folks, I'm telling you, there are people that say, when you die, you're going to become an angel. And I don't think so. This is a very special group of angels, by the way. We see this picture on the veil. And then 32 and 33, we see the arrangement of the veil. The support of the veil was simple. In verse 32, the Bible says, and you shall hang it upon the four pillars of acacia wood overlaid with gold. Their hooks shall be gold upon four sockets of silver. Now we see the pillars were to support the veil. The pillars are very unique. What does the number four represent? The number four represents support and strength. And these four pillars picture for us who would support Jesus, who would lift Him up. The four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all support Jesus in the Bible. Each and every one of them are dedicated to show us who He is and what He had done for us. We see here these four Gospels as they lead strength and support to us as we investigate Jesus the Messiah. The sockets of the veil were silver. The silver we talked about before, it speaks of redemption. The veil is supported by the redemption of the Lamb of God. When we come before Jesus, we're going to forever remember Him. We're ever, forever going to remember His redemption. Well, how are we going to do that? The Bible says in the Old Testament, when Jesus appears to the remnant of the Jewish people there in the land of Petra, and they see Him, they're going to look upon Him, the Bible says, whom they have pierced. And they're going to look upon Him and say, what are these marks in your hands? Beloved, the only man-made thing in heaven, as I've heard before, is the marks of the nails that pierced Jesus as he hung upon the cross. Oh, folks, we're going to be forever remembering the redemption of mankind. Every time we see Jesus, they're walking among the streets of glory. My parents, my family members, my friends who have all gone before me, when they see Jesus, they bow before him because they see upon his wrists and upon his feet the marks of redemption. Oh, they're sweeter than silver. You see, he was sold for 30 pieces of silver. He was sold for silver. It's the price of redemption. We see the sockets of the veil. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19 says, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by the tradition of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. Oh, beloved, we were redeemed not by silver as the firstborn was redeemed or as a slave was redeemed. God didn't say, I want to buy a slave in the world today. God didn't say, I want to buy some mediocre slave. They might be a part of my life. No, the Bible says he redeemed us with the precious blood of Christ. A lamb without blemish. And then we see not only the support of the veil, but we see the sockets of the veil. Then we see the securing of the veil. The Bible says they were going to have hooks should be of gold. Later we see there'll be clasps made of gold. Now gold represents the divinity of God. The Messiah is the Son of the living God. That's just it. There is no second choice. There is no, well, maybe he's this or maybe he's that. He could be Michael the archangel, or he could be such and such a person. No, he is the only begotten Son of God. The Bible declares it. So we see the securing of the veil, the hooks shall be gold. These are the divine nature of Christ. They literally latch on to the truth. 1 John 5:5 says, who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Next, we see in verse 33, the latter part of 33 through 35, the function of the veil. Well, what was the purpose of it, Pastor? Well, the purpose of the veil was simple. We see in verse 33, the latter part of it. The Bible says, and the veil shall be a divider for you between the holy place and the most holy, or the holy of holies. It's to be used to determine the placement of the ark and to establish the holy of holies. It is what, remember what Zola Levitt called the apartment of God on the earth. God came and dwelt in that place. No other man except for Moses and the high priest. Moses was called many times into the holy of holies to speak with God, whereas Aaron was only called once a year as the high priest. And from then on, the high priest once a year would be able to go into the Holy of Holies. He would go into the Holy of Holies three times to perform what is called the Day of Atonement, or Yom Kippur. Beloved, let me say to you that God has a holiness, and that he only called Moses because Moses was a picture of Jesus. Moses said, there's going to be one who is going to come who is like me. He's going to be a prophet like me, speaking of Jesus. We see the placement of the ark. We see the prevention of the access. The Bible says the veil was a divider. It stopped people. The priest coming into the holy place might have thought, I wonder what that looks like behind that veil. You ever had your parents tell you when you were a child, don't look in there? I found out where my parents used to hide some things every once in a while. You know, and I kind of knew ahead of time what those things were going to be at a certain time of the year when we would get those things. And I was very, very wrong to do so, because it really kind of took the magic away from the day. But you know, the whole bottom line was simple. We don't stick our nose where it doesn't belong. And God told the priest, you don't go in that place. That is a holy place. And you don't go in there because the day you go in there is the day you're going to die. We see that some of the priests sometimes didn't believe God. Nadab and Abihu. They went in and all they did was bring strange fire. What they brought was coals of their home into the holy place to put there in the altar of incense rather than taking the coals of fire like God instructed out of the place where they would put the sacrifice, the altar sacrifice that was covered by the blood of the animals. They took their own, and the Bible says it was strange fire. And the Bible says God killed them, killed these two priests. So the priests may have thought, I wonder what it's like back there. I wonder what it looks like, but none of them dared. None of them dared to do that. Why? Because it was a holy place. There was a prevention there. The veil served to divide a holy God from a sinful mankind. Isn't that sad? You see, it wasn't that way in the beginning. The Bible says that Adam and Eve heard God walking in the garden. And God called Adam, "Wherefore art thou?" God had met with Adam in the cool of the evening at a specific time, in a specific place, and Adam hid from God. Now, how do you hide from God, first of all? God was not asking Adam, "Where are you in relationship to the garden?" He was asking, "Where are you in relationship to me?" Because they had sinned and fallen short, and they had become less than what God had created them to be. They become sinful creatures. And lo and behold, from that point on, there was a separation between God and man until the veil. And Jesus came into this world. We see it was a physical representation of a spiritual reality. Jesus is the veil. We're going to see that when we close out our message tonight. Today, Jesus is the veil. Folks, we have to go through Jesus if we're going to have access to heaven. We're going to have to go through Jesus if it's going to be access into the Holy of Holies. And we see here a very interesting thing. What else did the veil provide? Oh, it's very unique. The veil was extremely unique. As it hung there upon, as you remember, I told you now, the height of the tabernacle was 15 feet. And as that curtain literally hung, they would take the priests and they would take long poles and they would take them off the hooks as they would get to travel, and they would take that veil and they would lay it over the Ark of the Covenant. And then they would lay another covering over that, and they would take it as they traveled. Now, when they put it back in the tabernacle, they did it backwards. They took their poles, they stuck it in that thing, and they walked backwards and hooked the veil onto the posts. Why? No one could touch the ark. No one could see the ark. Why? Because it was a picture of God. And he was holy. And men who were unholy could not touch it. We see here a very interesting thing, that we have here this door, this veil, which was a divider. Do you know that Jesus is either a door for a person or he is a wall for a person? Either he's going to hinder them from coming to heaven or he's going to help them come to heaven. Jesus said very simply in John, the 10th chapter, verse 7, then Jesus said to them again, "Most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep." If you want to go to heaven, the Bible says you have to go through Jesus. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father except through me." Now, if you wanted to go into the Holy of Holies, you had to go through the veil. You had to go past the veil. And folks, listen, the veil was either a wall of partition or it was a door of protection. And we see here that Jesus was the one who gave us access to the Father. Verse 34 and 35, we see the placement of the furniture very quickly. We see the placement in the Holy of Holies in verse 34. And you shall put the mercy seat upon the ark of the testimony in the most holy. And then in verse 35, we see in the holy place, there was the altar of incense, the golden lampstand, and the table of showbread. And the Bible says, you shall put them. And they were in specific areas. It was so specific that Rabbi Rashi said that each piece of furniture had to be 2.5 cubits from the wall. You could not even put it close to the wall. It had to be 2.5 cubits. Again, middle finger, elbow, that's a cubit. So you had to go 2.5 cubits from the wall. Why so explicit? Why so exact, preacher? Look back at verse 30. The Bible says, according to its pattern, which he was shown on the mountain. You see, the Bible is exact. It shows you the pattern of God. It shows you the pattern of God's will. It shows you the pattern of God's salvation. It shows you the pattern of God's love, God's grace, God's mercy. Everything according to the pattern, God said. Why? Because it's that way in heaven. Jesus prayed, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so we see God is saying here, I have a holy place, a little heaven on earth. You need to make it like I told you to. And so we see the placement of the furniture. Next, we see the door. We pass the veil. We look back towards the east, and there's the door in the opening of the tabernacle. In verse 36, it says, you shall make a screen. You shall make a screen. The Bible says, for the door of the tabernacle. Now again, we have the gate, which is the opening. We have the door, which is the door to the tabernacle. We have the veil, the three openings. We see the screen's distinction. Its operational design is very practical. It's a function that's very simple. It keeps out the wind and the sand out of the tabernacle. Can't keep the menorah lit if the wind keeps blowing, and you can't keep the showbread nice and fresh if you got sand blowing all over the place. That's just the practical aspect of it. When I was in the military, we had Quonset huts. It was amazing how much sand can blow into a Quonset hut from a little small door opening. Every day we had to sweep that thing out and then mop it out. And it had sand. It had so much sand. It was all, how can you get that much sand in that place, I thought. But it was, I think they probably threw it in there while we slept. But there's a practical function, and it functioned as a door. But also there was an obvious designation, a door. It allowed access in and out. What was that access to? That access was to be the service of God. There is an access for you to be a servant of God. There is an access. Every Christian, every born-again Christian is a priest under the order of Melchizedek, as Hebrews tells us. Now, beloved, let me say to you, you are a priest. You have access to do the work of God every day. You say, wait a minute, preacher, I don't come to church every day like you do. I do. I come to church every day. There's a lot of service to do in the church building. But let me tell you, our service is mobile like the tabernacle. You go with it as it goes everywhere. And you can learn to serve God where you're at, and it gives you access. Without Jesus, there is no service to God. You're just a religious person, perhaps. If you do nice, kind things, you give money to the poor, you do these different things, you know, that's a nice thing as a human being, but that's not service to the Lord. Can I give money to the poor as a service for the Lord? Yes, you can. But we see here, beloved, it's very simple. There's an obvious designation. That door, you go in and out, and you serve the Lord. When you go into the tabernacle, that's why you go in for. Now, there were other priests that went into the tabernacle. It wasn't their turn. You know, they took lots, like Zechariah. Remember, Zechariah went into the temple, and the angel appeared to him, Gabriel, and spoke to him about having a son. He wouldn't believe him, and they made him deaf. Made him dumb. He couldn't speak. The whole bottom line is there were other priests that came into that tabernacle area, not to just do work, but to come and worship. You know, sometimes we come to church and the Bible says, be still and know that I am God. But sometimes we just need to come and be still. There's sometimes we just need to come and listen for God's word, not to serve. Remember Mary and Martha? Martha was in there in the kitchen making her little flour pancakes. Mary was there at the feet of Jesus. Martha put her little apron a little tighter, walked into the room and said to Jesus, "Tell Mary to come and help me with the cooking, Jesus. I'm tired of being in the kitchen all by myself." And Jesus said, "Oh, Martha, Martha." And I love the way the King James Version says it. "Thou art cumbered about with much work." Oh, those priests sometimes made it so cumbersome to go in and do the work. There are many times, folks, we come to church and it's just so cumbersome. It's hard. It can be overcoming sometimes. It can make you tired. But, oh, Martha, you're so busy. When are you going to minister? And you see, Mary had chose the best. What did Mary do? She didn't hang a curtain. She didn't put a dish on the table. She didn't put the tablecloth down. She just sat at the feet of Jesus and anointed his feet with oil and his head with oil. Oh, he says, wherever she goes, wherever the gospel's preached, it's going to be told what she's done this day. We see the obvious designation. Then there's a specific designation. There's to be woven by a weaver. It had prophetic intent. The door is the picture of Jesus. Jesus said, "I am the door," in John 10:9. "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. And I will go in and out and find pasture." Or he will go in and out and find pasture. We can only do service for Jesus, beloved, as saved people. I know preachers that aren't saved. I know preachers that preach wonderful sermons that are not saved. They're not doing service for Jesus. We see here a prophetic intent. We, as the priesthood of Christ, of the order of Melchizedek, must be busy. You need to go to work tomorrow with an intent as a priest to worship Jesus. You need to go to the store tomorrow with an intent of worshiping Jesus. Well, what kind of service is there, preacher? Well, there's the fellowship. There's that bread at the table of showbread. The bread and the wine, so we can have that fellowship of Jesus. There are people at work you need to fellowship. Christian people you need to help, to encourage, pray for, fellowship with them. And then there's the light of the menorah, the light of the word. You need to read your Bible. You need to get prepared to go to work. And when you go to work, share the word of God. Be salt in a saltless society. And the Bible says there's that table of incense, that altar of incense representing our prayer life. Folks, you need to pray for people at work. There are people who are hurting at your work. You don't even know about it. You don't know what life they have at home. You don't know what tragedies that have come into their life. I've been praying for the Cox family all week long. Joe and Brenda used to be members here. Joe had served in many, many places. His son, Joe, died. That sheriff died. Well, what a tragedy to lose a child. I watched my parents lose 3 of their 4 children. I watched my dad bury every one of his sons except me and my mother. What a tragedy. Folks, that's a burden to bear. There are people at work right now. You're going to go there tomorrow. They have a burden that they may not be able to bear, that you can say to them, "Let me pray for you. You look stressed out. Is there something I can pray about?" You know, it'll shock them. You'll shock them. If you go to them and say to them, "You know, I kind of noticed you look a little discouraged. Can I pray for you? Something I can pray about?" Well, they might say something ugly to me. Well, they're not saying it to you, beloved. So do your service tomorrow. Whether it be at the table of prayer or at the table of light or at the table of the showbread fellowship, do your work tomorrow. Then we see the prophetic intricacy, the 4 colors. Again, once again, we see the blue and we see the purple. We see the scarlet. We see the white. That represents, again, the 4 gospels. The gospel of John, blue, the Son of God coming down from heaven. Purple, the gospel of Matthew, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, his messianic royalty. Scarlet speaks of the gospel of Mark, who shared to us the suffering servant, Jesus, the sacrificial lamb. And then the white pictures for us the gospel of Luke, the sinless Son of Man. And then we see the door's arrangement in verse 37. Its functional structure is very simple. And you shall make for the screen five pillars of acacia wood. There was a practical reason for five. The other one had four. The one at the ark, the one at the Holy of Holies, only had four. Why did this have five, preacher? Well, there was extra support for the priests and for this priest who would use that door a lot. There was a lot of moving back and forth in that because of their duty, but also because of devotion. Many of the priests just came into the holy place to lay on their face and pray. Many of them came to throw incense on the altar just to pray. Oh, they came there to find solace. They came there to find hope. Sometimes those priests came there to find assurance. Oh, beloved, why have you come today? You see, we all come to seek. We all come to find something. Has the Holy Spirit spoken to your heart as you've come into the house of God? And as they went into the house of God, they looked for duty and devotion. That was the practical reason. The prophetic reason was, again, the number five means grace. Five pillars, grace. The five sacrifices, grace. The acacia wood overlaid with gold pictures the incarnation of Christ. The wood was His human nature. The gold was His divine nature. The holy place was a place of service for the priests. You need to serve the Lord where He's placed you. In the place. Make your place at work a holy place. Make your place at school a holy place that you can serve God. You see, without Christ's incarnation, without the message of God in human flesh, there is no service. Philippians 2:8, and being found in the appearance as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. That's the gospel. Finally, there's the five sockets and the gold hooks and clasps. They picture Jesus too. The gold pictures Christ's deity. If we had time, we could go in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, and look at the picture of Jesus there with a golden sash across His chest with His white robe of purity. The picture also was a picture of Jesus was the gold, but the brass of the sockets were different than the silver sockets. Why? Because brass means judgment. You have to come to the judgment to serve God. You can't go into the service of Christ without passing through the judgment. When I was an 11-year-old boy, God judged me for all my sins. When I was an 11-year-old boy, the judgment of God fell not upon me, but upon Jesus that day I got saved. I went forward that Sunday and invited Jesus into my heart. Little did I know that about 2,000 years before, that God had judged His Son, His only begotten Son, on my behalf. And the judgment of God that would have fallen upon me fell upon Him. And the judgment that was meant for me, He took upon the cross. You see, you can't go through the door of the tabernacle without coming to the place of judgment. And oh, we went there to that old cross there at Calvary. Oh, beloved, there He hung upon that cross between heaven and earth so that you would be free, that you could serve Him, that you could live for Him, that He would take your judgment. Isaiah 53:12 says, therefore I will divide Him a portion with the great, and He shall divide the spoil with the strong, because He poured out His soul unto death, and He was numbered with the transgressors, and He bore the sin of many, and He made intercession for the transgression. Folks, He took it for you. Jesus is the door, and He is the veil. Jesus, the door, said in John 10:9, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, you'll be saved, and go in and out and find pasture. Jesus, the veil, in Hebrews 10, verse 19 and 20 says, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which He consecrated for us through the veil. Here it comes. That is his flesh. Oh, that veil was a picture of the body of Jesus as it hung upon the cross. So what happened to that veil? That veil in the temple, that glorious veil that separated man from God, what happened to that veil? Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 27. And we'll close with this. Matthew chapter 27. Jesus was hanging upon the cross. He just cried out with a loud voice. Look at verse 27, chapter 27, verse 50. 27, verse 50. And Jesus cried out with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked and the rocks were split. You see, the earth quaked after the veil was split. The earthquake did not split the veil. God did. See, that which divided us from God, that which kept us from the Lord, that which said only one person in fear and trembling and by the blood could he come, the Bible said, I'm going to open it up now through the body of Christ. Jesus died for you, shed his blood for you, that you can have direct access to me now. That's why Paul says to be absent from the body, be present with the Lord. You and I have direct access to God. Today, I prayed to God directly. Did you? You couldn't do that before. Now we can. We can go to God directly. We can go to God directly through the blood of Christ. Jesus' payment provided our way to heaven by the Father. That's why Jesus said you must be born again. Beloved, let me say to you, Christianity is more than just a religion. That's Christendom. Christianity is a relationship. And when I was an 11-year-old boy, I come to understand that he took my judgment, that I could have direct access to God. And beloved, if you're born again, you have that too. Let's pray.
Hi, my name is John Blair, and I have the privilege of being the pastor here at Coventry Baptist Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana. I want to thank you for choosing to take part in our online services. I sincerely hope they were a blessing to you, and I want to invite you to continue to use them in the weeks yet ahead. In fact, take your time on our website, check it out, let us know what you think about it. Your opinion is very important to us, and we'd like to have some feedback. Let me take this time to also extend an invitation to you. If you don't already have a church home, let me invite you to come to our church and take part in one of our weekly services. Our morning worship service on Sunday is at 10 a.m. Our Sunday night service is at 6 p.m. And our Wednesday services and our midweek service is at 7 o'clock p.m. We're located at 10926 Aboit Center Road. We're right across the street from Homestead High School. Just get on our website. We have a detailed map and some instructions on how to get here. Again, thank you for choosing our website and our services. I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you. I hope to see you this Sunday.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christ.